very much for this opportunity to visit Natal and to speak with you. This is actually the second time I've been to Natal. The first time was 23 years ago, and I had just finished my PhD and was starting work where I was working on antiferromagnets, which was also the beginning of a very long way of going around the world, but that's a different story. But it's also around the world in antiferromagnets, because I've come back to antiferromagnets, and I first chose that topic because I know there's many people interested in multiferroics, and the last talk, in fact, was a good example of all the various things we can think about with the interaction of light as a probe, which is why I want to present this to you today, as I've come back to antiferromagnets from the point of view of optics and ended up learning something about spintronics. So I'll tell you about that as well as I can in the time I've got. But first, let me say where I am now. After a rather long journey that took me to Australia and back over a course of 22 years, I started out here and found myself here in near the geographic center of the North American continent. And while I'm there, enjoying what is really a very lovely place, very interesting, there's also quite a number of research activities with six different groups in our university, which has a very long history of magnetism. And if you ever get a chance to go up to that side of the world, please come by. It's worth the visit. What I want to talk about in antiferromagnets is a journey through the electromagnetism and the optics point of view, and end up talking about spin currents, their generation, and also their interaction with spin waves. But most, I forgot to say something very important. The work I'm presenting is due to these two people, really, two very young, talented theoreticians, one of whom was born not so very far away from here and did a lot of his work with a fellow named Tom Dumoulin at the university not so far away. Another, Igor Proskurin, who's from Russia and was working in Japan for a while, both of whom, if you have any nice continuing positions, I would think carefully about. They're extremely good people. But I want to present their work as best I can, and these are various collaborators who've also contributed. Let me start out then. Is there a laser pointer I could borrow? I forgot to bring one. This one maybe? Oh, sorry, I point for a moment. I want to come at it from this point of view. I was surprised. I mean, these are all very interesting. Oh, thank you very much. These are all very interesting optical properties we've seen and read about and heard about and maybe observed. Negative index refraction, lenses which are made out of flat parallel surfaces, optical properties that can lead to cloaking. And I was surprised to learn that antiferromagnets do this too. Now, an example is an anisotropic crystal, and better known than antiferromagnets is something like quartz, which, if you align the crystal properly and shine light at it at the right frequency, you can observe also negative refraction. And the reason for this is because of the anisotropy, there are different components in the dielectric tensor, and by picking a resonant frequency to use, you can play off the signs between these and create a negative index material. Now, antiferromagnets are similar. It's in the permeability, not the dielectric tensor. But if you pick the right frequency, you can play off these components against one another and observe a number of interesting, and for me anyway, surprising optical effects. And I want to share two of those with you. But to do that, I just want to background, I apologize to those of you who already know this, but I just want to summarize some of the basic electromagnetism of antiferromagnets. First of all, there is complicated magnetic order, but not necessarily a net magnetization. And I have to show this picture, is one of the architects of our current understanding of antiferromagnets, and can be studied with various inelastic and scattering processes. He introduced a sublattice model, which is the one we've assumed in our calculation of permeabilities and the spin waves, which I'm going to talk about later. And it all goes about postulating some type of microscopic electron correlations leading to an exchange interaction that prefers anti-parallel alignment of localized magnetic moments. It's a variety of orderings. This is just a subset. You saw many more in the last talk. And one of the reasons I thought this maybe is appropriate topic is, of course, many multiferroics have antiferromagnetic order, and many of those also display a canted antiferromagnetic order, which is very important for understanding some of the optical properties that we predicted. So, next, how can we understand, in a simple way, some of the interaction of light with an antiferromagnet? We can do this by looking at the resonances of the permeability tensor, and those resonances can be calculated by studying the Landau-Lifshitz torque equations, one for each sublattice. So in a simple two-sublattice model, it's just a coupled set of six equations. And then we can put in a driving field, linearize and invert these equations, and come up with this permeability tensor. Then we'll calculate all the elements that I showed you in the previous slide. There's another thing for antiferromagnets. It's a strong anisotropy field, which leads to a preferred direction. So you can apply a magnetic field in one direction without necessarily changing the magnetic order, but if you apply it in the other direction, you may cause a canting. Okay. So what are these resonances? Well, this is an important part, because I want to draw an analogy between the antiferromagnetic spin wave and resonant dynamics and light, because there's actually a very deep analogy, and I hadn't realized how deep it was until just the past couple of years. At zero field, the resonances, and remember, if you want to think classically, that's fine. The sublattices are magnetic, but that means they're also angular momentum. The excitations are therefore precession of angular momentum. So you think in terms of precessions. So if this is the quantization axis, these vectors are a classical picture of the dynamic excitation, which is a precession about that quantization axis. Now, there are two sublattices, so there are two precessions going on simultaneously. In zero field, in an anti-parallel arrangement, there are two modes of precession. Now you can start thinking, what I'm going to in a minute, of circular polarization for optical light. There are two polarizations. So in zero field, there are two polarizations to these resonances, if you like. And if you apply a magnetic field, you break the degeneracy, and so go from having a single resonance in the permeability to a double resonance in the permeability. And as I said, you can break this in a couple of different ways. So if you apply the field parallel, then you go from, here's a real experiment, data, at zero field, there's degeneracy between these two polarizations. As you apply the field, you break that degeneracy and they split. And if you cant it by applying the field in a perpendicular direction, well, the spins rotate this way, a net moment is introduced. That net moment acts like a ferromagnet in many ways, and then there's also the other oscillations in that direction. There's a frequency diagram for this, which I'm not going to show you because I don't need that at the moment. So now, let's talk about the optics. I'll talk about two different types of optics, one of reflection and one of transmission, and two of the phenomena that are associated with the permeability and its special symmetry properties. Now, given the zero field resonances, we can calculate a response function through these permeabilities. We can put them into Maxwell's equations and predict reflection and transmission. These are magnon polaritons. And so, to look at the permeability as a function of frequency, you see that it has regions where it's positive and regions where it's negative. Negative regions then do not have propagating waves, and the positive regions do. And the location of these regions depend on any magnetic fields which are applied. So let's first take the case of reflection. So here's a very simple geometry. Here's an antiferromagnet, a two-sublattice one. And we choose an S polarization so that the electric field's pointing out of the plane of incidence. We have an incident angle and a reflected angle, and want to calculate the magnitude of the reflected field. So let's just think of that coefficient as a ratio of the reflected to the incident field amplitudes. Now here's an important one. We always draw these diagrams with a single arrow. Experiments are never a single arrow. The experiments are a single beam. That beam has a finite width. And because that beam has a finite width, there's an angle through which you can draw these arrows. which means that there's a small range of wave vectors parallel to the surface that you can take into account. When you do that, then to calculate the the incident field is going to be a superposition of a number of different wave vectors, all corresponding to the ways you can introduce an x component to the wave vector in the incident field, corresponding some distance here that you're fitting into the width of the beam. And so you need to sum over plane, even in a plane wave approximation, you need to sum over all of these. So that's what this integral represents, with an amplitude associated with each of the parallel wave vectors. And then if you want the reflection coefficient, you need to calculate the reflection coefficient weighted by all of that different transverse components. Now, what's interesting about this is that there's a shift, a lateral shift. Now, that's well known in other optical systems. But the magnetic system is a bit special because we have all of those components which can be tuned with magnetic fields, and most importantly, which depend on whether or not there's a canting. So what happens is you get a shift of this incident to the reflected beam, and it has some width, and if you apply a field so that you cant it, you introduce off-diagonal elements from this permeability tensor, which lead to non-reciprocity, meaning that if I switch the direction, I get a different d value for the shift. So it's a non-reciprocal, this effect is called Goose-Hanschen shifts, but this one is non-reciprocal, and it could be tuned by the degree of canting. I'm not aware of anyone who's done this with multiferroics, which may have a natural canting in them, but it would be an interesting thing to check because it would be non-reciprocal, and the width of that would tell you something about the canting and the strength of the fields which are causing that canting. Now, what happens if we talk about transmission and not reflection? So we talk about the light which goes into the antiferromagnet, which is a polariton, a magnetic polariton, and then what we find is by choosing a light intensity or a light incident at the right frequency, and that means near a resonance. Remember, we've got all these components in the permeability tensor whose resonances depend on the frequency and whose sign depend on exactly where that frequency is relative to the resonance. So we can actually start to play off all these different tensors which appear in the dispersion relation, which we've calculated directly from Maxwell's equations. So if we do that, we get an equation. If I go back to this dispersion curve, let me back up a little bit. Remember, what we're doing is solving the Maxwell's equations here, but now for a material that has tensor components from this permeability, which I showed you back up here. Whoops. Okay. And these off-diagonal elements are the ones which depend on field. So we're looking at these, and these when there's a field, and we're putting this whole thing into Maxwell's equations, and coming up with a dispersion curve, or a dispersion equation, which looks something like this. And if we rearrange it slightly, it has, look on this left-hand side, it has this form of the wave vectors that the wave is propagating in the material, weighted by these permeability coefficients, and equal to a frequency, and maybe some more complicated function over here. But if you look at that, this is the equation of an ellipse, or if you change the sign on one of these coefficients, it's the equation of a hyperbola. Now, if it were positive like that, and we were to plot in the propagation space the direction of the power flow associated with this wave going through the material, then if it's a hyperbola, or let's say just a perfect circle, I mean, if it's an ellipse or a perfect circle, the propagation is always isotropic, or if it's elliptical, it goes in some directions preferentially, but it's going outwards like this. That's the normal kind of Snell's law behavior we would expect. But if one of these signs is different, then it's a hyperbola where we have to do this mapping. And if we show the power flow of this is a constant energy surface, and the power flow is always normal to that surface, where it was radially outward and normal to the surface here, in the hyperbola, it's normal to the surface, but because of the geometry, it's pointed in a different direction relative to this one. That means light coming in is not reflected like the Snell's law that we're familiar with, but instead like a negative index material. So it's easier to see it if you look at the ray tracing. So if we repeat our incident wave, some of it's reflected. We talked about the Goose-Hanschen shifts. You can see there's a slight shift here and a broadening and some reflection and some oscillations here due to interference. But the bit which is at this particular frequency, we've chosen to be in the hyperbolic region, it's refracted in the opposite direction you would expect, not along the normal this way, but backwards. And then when it exits, it comes out parallel to the incident beam. So it's gone backwards in this way. This is very curious. And if you take that and start to exploit it in the same way you would with any optical metamaterial that does this sort of thing, you can start to imagine new geometries for optical elements. So did I mention that the antiferromagnet resonances are in the terahertz? So this is potential material for terahertz optics of different sorts. If you change the geometry of the crystal in this one, for example, so that the permeability axes are tilted relative to the surface normal, you could even make a non-reciprocal transmission device that acts like a mirror that moves the reflected part of your beam out of the way. So there's applications and devices that are possible here, but only at the frequencies in which you're working with a hyperbolic material. This is an example of two parallel surfaces where there's a point source here, light's incident. Because of this negative refraction effect, it's bent down to a focus on the inside of the material. So it's a slab lens. But I've also wanted to show you in this something else. So we've put damping into this, very, very little. But if there's very little damping, you can even see a finer structure. Because the way this is this ellipse I was talking about, the beam and the power is crossing each other. So there are interference effects. And these are very interesting little network of nodes. And you wonder what goes on at the intersection point. In electron optics, those intersection points are vortices. In optical beams, if you take into account the electromagnetic field, they're a bit different. It's a singular type of optics. Okay, how am I doing for time? Okay, I want to put in something very quick here. As I said, I wanted to say that how optics viewing antiferromagnets from an optical perspective led to a different understanding of metamaterials. That's one thing. But now I want to talk about what the consequences are for spintronics. Because it turns out that the antiferromagnet, if you look at just the equations for spin waves in antiferromagnets, formally they map onto Maxwell's equations. It's surprising. There's like two polarizations, which I talked about, in no field. And the dispersion at long wavelengths is linear. So that sort of gives you a hint that there's some symmetries. But if you look at the equations more carefully, you can put them in a one-to-one mapping form. That means we can start to draw conclusions about the excitations that are governed by the torque equations that describe spin waves inside antiferromagnets. We can draw analogies from optics, just like I drew analogies from dielectric optics to magnetic optics. So let me remind you about spin waves. We talked about resonances. This is a ferromagnet, it's just easier to draw. Resonances are when all the spins are processing in phase. Spin waves are when there's a phase difference from one spin to the other. So if you look at the precession angle and map it out, you see an oscillation. Okay, so the resonance is down here, but these spin waves are on some dispersion there. Antiferromagnets, I'm not even going to try to draw the different spin wave precessions, but they start here where you have these two circular polarizations, and that's at the resonance field here, and then it's a linear relationship, at least at long wave vectors. Mathematically, they're equivalent to optical waves. I'm just talking about antiferromagnetic spin waves now. Two polarization states, and here's the main thing. Just like for optics, we can define a chirality. We can define a chirality for antiferromagnets as well. And that has some interesting conclusions. So first, there's two examples, and then I'll be finished. The first one is this. For optical chirality, there's a thing called Lipkin's expression for chirality carried by an electromagnetic wave. Looks like this. And Tang and Cohen, a few years ago, defined a chiral density, which is the equivalent of that inside a material, which has a dielectric properties. And then they use that to explain dichroism on the absorption of optical light from chiral molecules. Well, if antiferromagnet spin waves have such an analogy to optical waves, perhaps we have something similar with antiferromagnets. And so Igor looked at this, and indeed he did find that there's a chiral density that can be defined for antiferromagnets that mathematically looks very similar to the one by Tang and Cohen for chiral materials. And here what enters is the M and L of an antiferromagnet. And what this does is, well, in the Tang and Cohen case, currents, material currents, charge currents in a material can act as a source or a sink for this chiral optical chirality. In other words, there's a conservation law involved on the chirality of the beam as it's transferred to the material. And so if we postulate the same thing here, spin waves, which have chirality in an antiferromagnet, there's two polarizations, chirality from the spin waves can be transferred to spin currents. I don't have time to show you the mechanism that we worked out, but basically if you introduce a spin polarized charge current through a material, it breaks a symmetry in the antiferromagnets. It's like a what do we call that, when the Doppler shift of the antiferromagnetic spin waves. And so there'll be a preferential absorption of one chiral magnon state over another. In other words, you can polarize the spin waves by application of the spin current. The second one, and then I'll be done, it's one slide. So with that in mind, let's ask what other conservation law consequences might arise. And so this one's a new one. Chirality of the light is proportional to its circular polarization. You have more right or left-handed circular polarization than the other. If chirality is conserved when it interacts with a material, such as an antiferromagnet, then we might expect production of, if it says coming in with more right polarization than the other, that should be reflected in absorption into a spin current that will also carry that polarization. And indeed, that's what we find. We find that these M and L components of the processing antiferromagnetic magnetization are proportional to a driving field B, which is oscillating near resonance of the spin waves. And we can then use conservation and show, either from torque equations, or we've done this also as a second order perturbation theory, that we can get a spin current which is produced. You see, we've aligned this field, this electromagnetic wave, so it's incident along the spin direction, and absorption will appear as a spin current which is polarized. And this is motivated by another analogy to an optical effect called the photogalvanic effect. And we looked at this for a couple of different ways. It's a second order nonlinear response. It'd be an interesting thing to look at, but it's a resonant response. It's not large, but it's not insignificant according to our estimates, so you might be able to measure it. So anyway, that brings me to the end of it. There's some other things I haven't talked about with cavity modes and antiferromagnets, but I can save that for later. But just to summarize, these field-tunable shifts from canting, the field just serves to cant the magnetization, and there's antiferromagnets near resonances can behave as with hyperbolic optics, with all these curious optical effects, and negative refraction, Guzhansch, and so on. And then talked about some consequences of chirality conservation, which we draw because of a formal analogy between antiferromagnetic spin waves and optical waves. So thank you.